Okay, everyone, welcome back. Previous video, we've gotten to the point where we've created three shots. So again, recapping really quickly before we continue. We have our establishing shot here, which cuts, shows our character getting up and turning around and revealing our enemy bear, which we're gonna do battle with, and then kind of a push in on the bear to kind of showcase him a little bit better. So we have three shots, and the workflow that we've taken so far has been on a shot-by-shot basis. So we've created one shot, and inside of that shot, we've done all of our animation, we've assigned our camera until we were happy with that shot, and then we moved on. So we did that for shot two and shot three as well. Moving forward, we're gonna do something a little bit different. We're gonna take a different workflow approach. It's something that you could use. It just depends on the makeup of your team and how you wanna proceed. But we did wanna showcase that there are different ways that you can use Sequencer. And the approach that we're gonna take now could support more of a collaborative effort. So if you have a large team of cinematic designers or artists or animators, they could all work on the same sequence concurrently without stepping on each other's work and stepping into the same particular shot. And we're gonna do that using what's called a subscene track. So we're gonna get to that in a moment. In fact, we're gonna get to it right now. Let's go ahead and continue. We're gonna jump to the end of our master sequence here. And at the very end, I'm gonna click on shot three. I'm gonna right click on it now and say insert shot. So we're gonna insert a shot after shot 03. It's the same thing as going to the content browser and saying create new level sequence and then adding it to the shot track, just another shortcut that we can take here. So I'm gonna say insert shot, and we're gonna call this shot 04. Like so, so it'll add it to the end, like so, which is fine. And then what we're gonna do is we're gonna right click on shot 03 one more time here. And we're gonna say duplicate shot this time. So duplicate shot 03, like so. And save that inside of the cinematics folder, but we're gonna call this animation. So we're gonna call this animation. We're not gonna necessarily need it on the master track, so I'm gonna delete the animation shot now. Just wanted to create the asset. And then let's move shot 04 back. And then we can move our timeline. We could say, let's just go to 1,000. Say that's the end, like so. Okay, so we have shot 04. Again, this is something that we like to do as well, just to delineate between shots, is just to alternate rather than have them all on the same line like this. It's just a lot easier to see where the breaks happen in this manner. So jump into shot 04 now. And inside of shot 04, it should be empty. Should be nothing in here. We're gonna add what's called the subscene track. So I'm gonna go to the add button over here, and below play rate, we have subscenes track. And this will add a new track that can contain other sequences. So it's very similar to a shot track. So go ahead and add this, the subscene track. And then we have the ability to add a sequence, and the sequence that we're gonna add is animation. So I'm gonna add that. And it's gonna have four tracks in it, and it's gonna be pretty long. I'll show you why if we jump into it now. It's gonna contain our entire level sequence thus far. Doesn't have all the camera cuts and all that, but it's pretty much all the animation up until this point, which is great, because this track is gonna contain only animation assets. So I'm gonna delete the camera cuts. I'm gonna delete the camera actor as well. So now we have this track that has just the two characters and their animations in it. And we can continue with our scene, building out the rest of the scene, the animation for just this. Now, how is this useful? So if we hop back up, you can see right now we're three levels deep now. We're inside of an animation track, which is inside of shot four, which is inside the master. So if we were to hop back up to shot four, we have our animation track here. Now, suppose you had somebody that was an FX artist or a sound designer. They could come in and have their own tracks, one labeled sound for sound effects for the audio team, FX for FX artists, camera person could have their own track as well. And you could layer these on top of each other to comprise shot 04. That way each person can come in and work on their own individual aspects of shot 04 without having to go into, say, something like this and having cameras and characters and all that stuff in the particular shot. So it's just a different approach you can take. So for us, let's go ahead and stretch this all the way out, and let's go back up to the master real quick. Just want to check something. So we want to actually end right there, right where shot 04 ends. So 467, 68, looks good. Okay, so if we go into here now, let's see. We need to go to the end of this. Move this over. Let's go to 1,000 for this. So Control G, 1,000, except. So this is the end of our sequence. This is everything that we've done up until this point. And now we can continue from here inside the animation track and add the rest of the animations. So let's go ahead and start doing that. So we need to go in the animations. We'll bump this one up to say 1,000. Add the endpoint. And here is the end of our scene. So let's continue. So next thing that we're going to want to do for our scene, I'm actually going to maximize this, because right now we're pretending that we are the animator. We don't care about camera cuts. We don't know where the camera is going to be. All we want to do is create the content so that our cinematic designers can come in and say, okay, here's all the content. Let's populate the cameras and set up the shots as we see fit. So for us, our job is to just finish off the rest of the animation. So at this point, we have the bears kind of idling. Our grunt's kind of idling. What we're going to want to have happen is our bear's going to walk forward towards our grunt here, take a swipe at our grunt. Our grunt's going to react and then get up. And then he has this cannon that's on the back that we're going to fire a projectile at, a fake projectile. I'm doing air quotes right now that you can't see. Fire a projectile at our bear, who's going to then play a hit react and then die. And then our character is going to just stand there looking cool, doing an idle. And then that's going to pretty much be the scene. So we need to create the animations for that content. So we're going to start by first having our bear walking forward here. So for the enemy bear, let's add an animation at the end of our idle here. And it's just going to be a walk forward, which is just walk. Let's add that. It's a very short animation that we can loop. So I'm going to stretch it out, say, 4 times maybe. We'll see how that does. So 4 full walk cycles is what we're going to use here. Now, you'll notice if we scrub ahead that the bear just walks in place. This particular animation does not have built-in translation, so it just stays in the same place. Versus something like if we were to add, let's see, I think there's like a melee. Yeah, like a melee B, for example. And I select my bear here. If you take a look at the transform here, as I attack, I push off of it and away from it. So has some built-in translation there with that attack versus the walk where he's just walking in place. So I'm going to delete that for now because we're going to come back to that a little bit later. So I'm going to zoom in, make sure that this is lined up like so. And yep. So in order to make this bear move, we're actually going to have to use our transform track here. So we'll initialize the current position, and then we'll move him forward, move the timeline forward, and then add a key for the new position. So with our bear selected here, I'm just going to press S, add our initial transform. Going to scrub ahead to the end of our animation here, like so. And I'll slide this forward. I could probably even push it up a little bit, somewhere to about right there. I'm not quite sure exactly where we want to go, but I'm going to hit S there and see what that looks like. So now you see we're actually moving the bear forward. Now, there might be a little bit of sliding here. Let's see. It's not too bad. If we move the time further out, you might notice like sliding a little bit, or he's moving too slow in one place. Or if we move it in, that's probably when you'll see the sliding a little bit better. Yeah. So you'll have to play with it and see what looks best. I think this doesn't look too bad. I think it's okay. Looks pretty realistic to me. So that's our motion. It does kind of slide a little bit at the end there. Just double check. Probably. I'm going to leave it where it is. We'll do an animation and see, because he's going to perform a melee attack here. We'll do an animation and see what that looks like. So let's go ahead and do something for our other character here, so he's not just standing there. Let's add an animation for him. His animation is going to be a summon, cast summon. And it just looks like a taunt, kind of. So he kind of just throws his weapons in the air and growls. It looks kind of cool. But it ends before our bear gets to its final position. So what I'll do is I'll just slide this over a little bit. And here's his idle. I'm just going to extend that out. Maybe a full cycle. Move that over, see what this looks like. And as our bear gets to the end, This is where we're going to perform a melee attack from our bear. So at the end on our bear here, let's add an animation for this. We'll say melee, if I can spell it. We're going to use that melee B because that looked pretty good because he translated forward and it should hit our character there. Let's see if I guesstimated right. Oh, just a little bit short. It looks like a little bit short. So what I could do is, let's see, let's select our bear. At this point, let's move the transform forward just a little bit more. Press S. So that's the new position he's going to. And then, yeah, that looks much better. Now don't worry about this cut right here, that little cut, because we're gonna, or pop, because we're gonna cut the camera actually towards the end here once we start doing the rest of our shot. So we'll cut to hide this little pop right there. Future iterations of Sequencer may have some additional blending options for things like this, and there's something else that we're gonna get to at the end of this video that we'll actually tackle and address in the next video. But hopefully down the line, as Sequencer gets further and further along, some more advanced blending options will become available. But for now, we'll show you how you can fix some of these. So our bear is performing a melee attack. Our guy stopped idling before the bear got there. So I'm going to stretch this out even more, maybe to the point where he's like looking up, not even paying attention. He's growling. And then that's when he gets hit. Looks good to me. Something like that. So we'll need to stretch our idle out again to there. Still idling, starts taunting, bear attacks, and right about there we're going to need to switch and play a hit react for this character. So about frame, you could do that 41, 42. We'll try 41 just to see what it looks like. So I'm going to stretch that back, and at this point we'll add an animation for our grunt, and it's going to be hit. Oh, is it react? Yeah, so react, we're going to do the knockback front here. So I'm going to select this. And what that should do is, as soon as we get hit, looks pretty good. Ideally, it would be the other way, because I'm hitting with the left hand with the bear. He would turn the other way, but we're going to work with the animations we got. I think this is fine. Looks pretty cool to me. Now, our bear is going to need to go back into an idle after he performs his melee attack, because he's just standing there. So we're going to hop back up to the bear here, add an animation for that. It's going to be an idle. So that he goes back into an idle, and our character stands up. Then when our character stands up over here, he's going to perform a ranged attack with his little cannon there. So we'll search for ranged, and we'll assign the ranged attack. Now, this is the point where we're going to pause, actually, because there's some things that we need to address with translation here. So if I select my bear here, and I play my melee, I think my bear is okay. It's mostly this guy here, actually. Yeah, you can see it right there. So we talked about the built-in translation that our bear didn't have on its walk. This character has a lot of it on this react here. So you can see this is where he starts. So when he gets hit, he gets knocked way off that position. When he plays his next animation, he pops back to it to play. So we're going to have to fix that. And we're going to fix that in the next video, actually. So we're going to pause here. That's going to do it for this video. We've set up quite a bit of the animation. We're almost done. We'll finish it off in the next video, which should be a pretty short one. Thank you guys for watching. We'll see you then.